Okay, let's hit the daily Bible reading for July 2nd. July 2nd of 2020 is a Thursday. And I hope you're enjoying the adventure in God's Word. Let's get right to it. 2nd Chronicles. That's August. July 2nd, not August 2nd. July 2nd is 2nd Kings, chapters 20 through 22, verse 2. Let's see what's going on here. Chapter 20. So, you know, the angel of the Lord, we just finished where the angel of the Lord conquered the Assyrian camp, basically. 185,000 Assyrian soldiers died at the hand of the Lord. Yeah, pretty miraculous, right? There you go. So, let's move on. And, as predicted by the prophet, King Sennacherib of the Assyrian army, he went one day, was worshiping in the temple of his god Nisroch. Remember that? His sons Adramelech and Sharezer killed him with their swords. So just as the prophet said, they then escaped to the land of Ararat, and another son, Ershadon, became the next king of Assyria. So chapter 20. Let's see what happens now with Hezekiah. About that time, Hezekiah became deathly ill, and the prophet Isaiah, son of Amoz, went to visit him. He gave the king this message. This is what the Lord says. Set your affairs in order. You are going to die. You will not recover from this illness. Imagine if a man of God or any prophet comes and says, prepare, you're about to die. Wow, okay, let's move on. Verse 2, when Hezekiah heard this, he turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord. Remember, O Lord, how I have always been faithful to you and have served you single-mindedly, always doing what pleases you. Then he broke down and wept bitterly. Ah, there he goes. He's pleading with the Lord. But before Isaiah had left the middle courtyard, this message came to him from the Lord. Go back to Hezekiah. How about that? The leader of my people, tell him, this is what the Lord, the God of your ancestor David, says. I have heard your prayer and seen your tears. I will heal you. And 3 days from now, you will get out of bed and go to the temple of the Lord. I will add 15 years to your life, and I will rescue you and this city from the king of Assyria. I will defend this city for my honor and for the sake of my servant David. So, the humility and repentance of King Hezekiah, or, you know, just his pleading, because he had been faithful to the Lord, did change God's mind. Pause. Even though we believe in the sovereignty of God and God's will always prevail, the Lord still loves his people. And people say, well, we can't change God's mind. I'm like, that doesn't bear witness in Scripture, right? The Lord will hear from his people. And he is compassionate, and, you know, scriptures are full of this. God is love. He shows mercy and loving kindness towards his people. So here's one of his kings who's always loved him. So God changes his mind. He says, okay, I give you 15 more years. How about that? So don't ever feel like you can't pray and change the heart of God. That's the key thing to remember here. Verse 7. Then Isaiah said, make an ointment from figs. So Hezekiah's servant spread the ointment over the boil, and Hezekiah recovered. An ointment from figs. Well, Lord, is that a medicine? I've got to read that up. Question mark. I'm putting up here figs ointment. How about that? Maybe a homeopathic remedy, Lord. Okay. No, it's God's will. The ointment was part of a process, but here you go. That was from the prophet. Meanwhile, Hezekiah had said to Isaiah, what sign will the Lord give to prove that he will heal me and that I will go to the temple of the Lord 3 days from now? Isaiah replied, this is the sign from the Lord to prove that he will do as he promised. Would you like the shadow on the sundial to go forward 10 steps or backward 10 steps? What? The shadow always moves forward, Hezekiah replied, so that would be easy. Make it go 10 steps backward instead. So Isaiah the prophet asked the Lord to do this, and he caused the shadow to move 10 steps backwards on the sundial of Ahaz. Folks, God made the sun appear to go backwards for a sign. Or he just made the shadow move and the sun didn't change at all. Powerful. A miracle, of course. Signs, wonders, and miracles. That's God's way. Soon after this, Merodach Baladan, son of Baladan, king of Babylon, sent Hezekiah his best wishes and a gift, for he had heard that Hezekiah had been very sick. Hezekiah received the Babylonian envoys and showed them everything in his treasure houses, the silver, the gold, the spices, and the aromatic oils. He also took them to see his armory and showed them everything in his royal treasuries. There was nothing in his palace or kingdom that Hezekiah did not show them. Then Isaiah the prophet went to King Hezekiah and asked him, "What did those men want? Where were they from?" Hezekiah replied, "They came from the distant land of Babylon." "What did they see in your palace?" Isaiah asked. "They saw everything," Hezekiah replied. "I showed them everything. I own all my royal treasuries." "They saw everything," he replied. "I showed them everything I own, all my royal treasuries." I don't think that was smart. Let's see what Isaiah says. Then Isaiah said to Hezekiah, "Listen to this message from the Lord. The time is coming when everything in your palace, all the treasure stored up by your ancestors until now, will be carried off to Babylon. Nothing will be left, says the Lord. Some of your very own sons will be taken away into exile. They will become eunuchs who will serve in the palace of Babylon's king." Ugh. Then Hezekiah said to Isaiah, "This message you have given me from the Lord is good." For the king was thinking, "At least there will be peace and security during my lifetime." He's not seeing the whole picture. The rest of the events in Hezekiah's reign included the extent including the extent of his power and how he built a pool and dug a tunnel to bring water into the city are recorded in the Book of the History of the Kings of Judah. Hezekiah died, and his son Manasseh became the next king. All right, so here we are, July 2nd. We're continuing on 2 Kings chapter 21. Manasseh was 12 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 55 years. His mother was Hephzibah. He did what was evil in the Lord's sight, following the detestable practices of the pagan nations that the Lord had driven from the land ahead of the Israelites. He rebuilt the pagan shrines his father Hezekiah had destroyed. The boy, was he not educated? See, isn't it interesting that even within kingdoms, the offspring are not learning from the righteous kings and vice versa. Sometimes there's a dark king and the sons. So there's all these influences within a kingdom. Sound familiar? Yeah, cultures are affected by how people are taught and what they turn their ear to and the power of free will. Everybody chooses on their own. That's what shows here through history. Wow. He rebuilt the pagan shrines that Hezekiah destroyed. He constructed altars for Baal and set up Asherah poles, just as King Ahab of Israel had done. He also bowed before all the powers of the heavens and worshiped them. There's weirdos that, shouldn't say that. People that are led astray that worship nature, sun, moon, and stars, and trees. And it's good. We honor creation as followers of the Lord. But we do not worship anything created. We worship the living God. So to honor something is not worshiping. To respect it is to respect it in the Lord because it's all the Lord's. The scriptures say the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. All of creation worships the living God. Right? Angels and saints and people in the spirit realm, they all worship the Lord unless they're Satan and the fallen angels. There you go. It's that simple. Verse 4, he built pagan altars in the temple of the Lord. Oh my goodness. So he's building pagan altars in the temple. What blasphemy. The place where the Lord had said, "My name will remain in Jerusalem forever." He built these altars for all the powers of the heavens in both courtyards of the Lord's temple. Manasseh also sacrificed his own son in the fire. Ugh. He practiced sorcery and divination, and he consulted with mediums and psychics. Pause. even today, Christians should never consult anything but prayer and seeking the will of the Lord by the Holy Spirit. We don't look for other ideas, because those are demonic realms where, yeah, familiar spirits, dark spirits are speaking through people, and that sounds pretty close, pretty good. No, we don't want that counsel. No, I don't even like it on TV shows where psychics are on TV, or I see this, or I'm like, they're not of the Lord. We don't want that advice. I don't want to hear it. Sorry. Well, I'm not sorry. It's just truth. We don't need the consultation of dark forces. He did much that was evil in the Lord's sight, arousing his anger. I always tell people, sorry, I got to throw this in. If you've ever done that, just repent. Say, Lord, I'm sorry. Gosh, didn't even know. Now you know. And I encourage people, don't do that. You know? Yeah, some people read your horoscope. I mean, that's entertainment. But still, I don't think anything of it. I don't consider that. It's just ideas, you know. Fortune cookies, you know, so what? You know, hey, they're just kind of, they're stealing ideas from the Lord. But I don't use those things as influence. It's comedy to me. But some people take it seriously, and we never should. We don't look at that as like, okay, speak to me, you know. No, we don't do any of that, period. Verse 7, Manasseh even made a carved image of Asherah and set it up in the temple, the very place where the Lord had told David and his son Solomon, my name will be honored forever in this temple and in Jerusalem, the city I have chosen from among all the tribes of Israel. If the Israelites will be careful to obey all my commands, all the laws my servant Moses gave them, I will not send them into exile from this land that I gave their ancestors. But the people refused to listen, and Manasseh led them to do even more evil than the pagan nations that the Lord had destroyed when the people of Israel entered the land. How far have they fallen? Terrible. Yeah. Then the Lord said through his servants, the prophets, King Manasseh of Judah has done many detestable things. He is even more wicked than the Amorites. How about that? So even the foreign tribes, he's becoming more detestable than them. Wow. They lived in the land before Israel. And he has caused the people of Judah to sin with his idols. So this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I will bring such disaster on Jerusalem and Judah that the ears of those who hear about it will tingle with horror. I will judge Jerusalem by the same standard I used for Samaria and the same measure I used for the family of Ahab. I will wipe away the people of Jerusalem as one wipes a dish and turns it upside down. Then I will reject even the remnant of my own people who are left, and I will hand them over as plunder for their enemies. For they have done great evil in my sight and have angered me ever since their ancestors came out of Egypt. People, the nature, you know, this is the Israelites, right? They should have never left the Lord. But the heart of mankind is to wander. Unless you're fully dedicated to the Lord, your heart will wander. Sad. Verse 16, Manasseh also murdered many innocent people until Jerusalem was filled from one end to the other with innocent blood. This was in addition to the sin that caused the people of Judah to commit, leading them to do evil in the Lord's sight. The rest of the events in Manasseh's reign and everything he did, including the sins he committed, are recorded in the Book of the History of the Kings of Judah. When Manasseh died, he was buried in the palace garden, the garden of Uzzah. Then his son Amon became the next king. Amon was 22 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 2 years. His mother was Meshulameth, the daughter of Haruz from Jotbah. He did what was evil in the Lord's sight, just as his father Manasseh had done. So he's no better off. He followed the example of his father, worshiping the same idols his father had worshipped. He abandoned the Lord, the God of his ancestors, and he refused to follow the Lord's way. So it sounds like even in those days, there's still the prophets of the Lord calling out to leaders, but nobody's listening. His decision is to follow his father and not to hear the men of God. Verse 23, then Amon's own officials conspired against him and assassinated him in his palace. But the people of the land killed all those who had conspired against King Amon, and they made his son Josiah the next king. The rest of the events in Amon's reign and what he did are recorded in the Book of the History of the Kings of Judah. He was buried in his tomb in the Garden of Uzzah. Then his son Josiah became the next king. Okay, July, we're still here in chapter, we'll go on chapter 22, just a couple verses, so hang in there. 2 Kings 22, verse 1. Josiah was 8 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 31 years. His mother was Jedidah, the daughter of Adaiah from Boscath. He did what was pleasing in the Lord's sight and followed the example of his ancestor David. He did not turn away from doing what was right. Another example, something trained this boy, the young king. Somebody turned his heart to the Lord and he got it. Isn't that amazing? So there you go. All right, I'm not going to comment more on that. It's just the nature of free will and influences. Those are two things, how we're influenced and where your free will land in it. All right, let's move on. Today, July the 2nd, Psalm 150, the last psalm in the book of Psalms, verses 1 through 8. Anonymous author, but a great closing to the book of Psalms, a closing hymn of praise. God's creation praises him everywhere in every way, and we should join this rejoicing song of praise. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his mighty works. Praise his unequaled greatness. Praise him with the blast of the ram's horn. Praise him with the lyre and the harp, right? Praise him with tambourines and dancing. Yes, Lord. Praise him with strings and flutes. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Psh, yes, Lord. Praise him with loud clanging cymbals. Let everything that breathes sing praises to the Lord. Praise the Lord. So many great songs from Psalm 150. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. And let the music proclaim. There you go. So many great songs. Okay, folks, we'll start back in another round of Psalms tomorrow. All right, July 2nd. Today's proverb is Proverbs 18, verses 9 through 10. A lazy person is as bad as someone who destroys things. Ooh, push against laziness. The nature of our flesh is to sluggishness. I hate that. Push against it. No, what should I set my hand to today, Lord? Doesn't mean we shouldn't rest. Be in the Lord's timing of our lives. We don't want to work to kill ourselves. But there's a thing about being slothful. And it says it's just like somebody that destroys things. Isn't that something? Wow. Verse 10, the name of the Lord is a strong fortress. The godly run to him and are safe. Another great song. Man, the name of the Lord is bum boom, a strong tower. The righteous run into it. And they are saved. Da-do-do-do. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, a fortress. And the godly run to him for safety. That's what we do. When you want to be safe, hide in the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all our heart. And leaning not on our own understanding. Okay, let's move on to Acts. I love the book of Acts. Love it all, actually. All right, July 2nd, Acts 21, picking it up at verse 18. 18 through 36. So Paul's arriving in Jerusalem, right? So here we are. Remember, he's been traveling a bunch, and he was originally from Cyprus. Some believers from Caesarea accompanied him. Where did he go? Okay, let's go on. So here we go. He's headed to Jerusalem. Verse 18. Acts 21. The next day, Paul went with us to meet with James, and all the elders of the Jerusalem church were present. After greeting them, Paul gave a detailed account of the things God had accomplished among the Gentiles through his ministry. After hearing this, they praised God. And then they said, "You know, dear brother, how many thousands of Jews have also believed, and they all follow the law of Moses very seriously. But the Jewish believers here in Jerusalem have been told that you are teaching all the Jews who live among the Gentiles to turn their backs on the laws of Moses. They've heard that you teach them not to circumcise their children or follow other Jewish customs. What should we do? They will certainly hear what you have done, and they will certainly hear you have come. Here's what we want you to do. We have four men here who have completed their vow. Go with them to the temple and join them in the purification ceremony, paying for them to have their heads ritually shaved. Then everyone will know that the rumors are all false and that you yourself observe the Jewish laws. As for the Gentile believers, they should do what we have already told them in a letter. They should abstain from eating food offered to idols, from consuming blood or the meat of strangled animals, and from sexual immorality. Pause. So there you go. Jewish people can still do customs and follow the laws, as is their tradition. Interesting. There's nothing wrong with that. And the Gentiles don't need to do that. Because those things are remembrances or traditions of men, although it is a law of Moses for the Jewish people, it's interesting. If it was something the Lord was requiring, the Lord would have made the Gentiles live like Jews. But there's nothing wrong with either. But there were certain spiritual things about not eating meats offered to other idols. You get the significance of that, or things from consuming blood, because blood is a significant, powerful thing. Plus, I think that's kind of unclean in a way. If you think of it, it's not really healthy, and the Lord knows that, but it represents something of the atoning sacrifice of blood. That's why the Lord doesn't want it. And sexual immorality, man, the list of that can go on, right? Because that perverts our perception of honoring covenant marriage and honoring who we are as spirit beings to live sexually immoral. So we just don't do that and avoid it at all costs. So we move on. There you go. Jews and Gentiles can practice different ways. All right. But remember, to my Jewish friends, following the law, doing ritual, following feast are all great celebrations and remembrance to honor the Lord, but they do not bring salvation. That is key to remember that. I hope people understand that, Jew or Gentile. Jesus said, when the young man asked, what do I got to do to be saved? The Lord says, believe on the one whom God sent. Now people say that, well, that's kind of oversimplifying. No, it's not. It means God is gracious and has a way to navigate different peoples. His people can do this. Let's see what Paul did. So Paul went to the temple the next day with the other men. They had already started the purification ritual, so he publicly announced the date when their vows would end and sacrifices would be offered for each of them. Then 7 days were almost ended when some Jews from the province of Asia saw Paul in the temple and roused a mob against him. They grabbed him, yelling, "Men of Israel, help us. This is the man who preaches against our people everywhere and tells everybody to disobey the Jewish laws. He speaks against the temple and even defiles this holy place by bringing in Gentiles." For earlier that day, they had seen him in the city with Trophimus, a Gentile from Ephesus, and they assumed Paul had taken him into the temple. So they assumed that. So see, still this clash on the idea of law and grace, right? 2 Kings, we're going to move on up to 22 verse 2. Just hang on. So let's see what happens. The whole city was rocked by these accusations, and a great riot followed. Paul was grabbed and dragged out of the temple, and immediately the gates were closed behind him. As they were trying to kill him, word reached the commander of the Roman regiment that all Jerusalem was in an uproar. He immediately called out his soldiers and officers and ran down among the crowd. When the mob saw the commander and the troops coming, they stopped beating Paul. Then the commander arrested him and ordered him bound with two chains. He asked the crowd who he was and what he had done. Some shouted one thing and some another. Since he couldn't find out the truth in all the uproar and confusion, he ordered that Paul be taken to the fortress. As Paul reached the stairs, the mob grew so violent, the soldiers had to lift him to their shoulders to protect him, and the crowd followed behind, shouting, "Kill him! Kill him!" As Paul was about to be taken inside, he said to the commander, "May I have a word with you?" "Do you know Greek?" the commander asked, surprised. "Aren't you the Egyptian who led a rebellion some time ago and took 4,000 members of the assassins out into the desert?" So this officer has no idea. "No," Paul replied, "I am a Jew and a citizen of Tarsus in Cilicia, which is an important city. Please let me talk to these people." The commander agreed, so Paul stood on the stairs and motioned to the people to be quiet. Soon a deep silence enveloped the crowd, and he addressed them in their own language, Aramaic. Right? Most of New Testament writing is written in Aramaic or Koine Greek, common language of the day, not Hebrew like all of the Old Covenant. Very significant. Chapter 22. "So brothers and esteemed fathers," Paul said, "listen to me as I offer my defense." When they heard him speaking in their own language, that the silence was even greater. So we are going to pick it up tomorrow. We're not going to go farther, and even the daily reading stops there at verse 2, which seems strange to me. But there you go. Paul is going to eventually die. Sorry to give it away, but those of you that may know, all the apostles, many of the apostles, all died martyrs except John the Beloved, who died at an old age and wrote the book of Revelation and other books. And he was sent in exile to Patmos on an island. Yeah. All right. We'll pick up chapter 22 tomorrow. Bless you all. We'll see you then for another daily Bible reading. Bye-bye.